Okay, tonight, you ready? We've got, I don't know, maybe probably till at least the end of February, we're going to stay in this series. Because honestly, to discover who God is, we could do this for years, couldn't we? We could. And so God is awesome, so I am humble. I was thinking today about some of the most awesome things I've ever seen. The most awe-inspiring things I've ever seen. Niagara Falls, breathtaking, totally breathtaking. This is going to sound weird, but a baby being born. I got to be in the room when my younger sister had her third baby, and I just bawled because it is, I don't know, like when I was giving birth to my babies, she had her baby before I had any of mine. So I had not experienced childbirth on my own, but I can't even imagine for you to have been with your kids or to see your daughter have a baby to bring a life into this world. And I just bawled. It was so beautiful and breathtaking. One of the most awe-inspiring things was at a campground in Iowa. And on this road, Lonnie took us down this road, and it was literally called Firefly Lane. And I think I would rank that experience with Niagara Falls. It was just like to be in this dark road and thousands of lights in this cornfield. It was awe-inspiring. Just wondered for you, anyone have just a quick image that popped into your mind of a truly awe-inspiring sight that you experienced? The first time seeing the ocean, yeah. First time seeing the mountains. Waterfalls, the Grand Canyon. Hey, y'all, I'm going to be there next week. Oh, I get to go with my hubby. We're going to Arizona next week for our anniversary trip. And I've never been to the Grand Canyon, and I can't even stand myself. I have researched. I read a book. I mean, like, I've done all the things. So, yeah. Anything else? An eagle. Yeah. Angela. On a cruise. Yeah. Isn't this interesting? Something that was breathtaking and awe-inspiring to you is freaky and scary to some. Thinking of being in the middle of the ocean where you can't see any land. You aren't going on a cruise anytime soon with Lewis, are you? Standing on Pike's Peak. Yeah. Okay. Holy Hill, for those online, she said Holy Hill in Milwaukee. That's interesting. Yeah. Let's define awesome awe. It's awe-inspiring. The term refers to an emotion combining honor, fear, and respect before someone of superior office or actions. It's most appropriately applied to God. How beautiful that He is awesome. And we just throw that term around so carelessly. Like I said, it's all awesome. But if we can just get in our minds this reverent, holy fear, awe-inspiring wonder of God. That's really where we're talking tonight. Because God is awesome, I am humble. So let's dig in. How many of you have been going through the Bible recap with us? Some of you guys been doing the Bible recap. I'm loving it. We just got done with Job somewhere last week, didn't we? And I will tell you, Job feels like a really long book. Because it's a lot of let's just go through this. It is, and if I was going to summarize it, which I did, I kind of summarized it in these four thoughts. What is Job 1 through 37? It's testing. We see the very beginning of the book where in the throne room, it is as if there is a elder meeting, a board meeting that is happening in the throne room, the conference room of heaven, and we see that Satan is what he would have been called. He approaches God. God brings up his servant Job. So what do we see in the first 37 chapters? We see testing. We see things taken. Job loses all of his land, his livestock, all of his possessions he loses. We see terrible tragedy. He loses his children. Not one child, not the bad child, but all the children. And we see tormenting talks, which really is the brunt of Job. It's these talks with his friends. Remember, and I use air quotes, Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar, and then the younger one who's kind of listening. And at the end, he just can't stand himself anymore. And Elihu finally is like, dude, you guys are older, but I can't stand it. And I got to talk for a little bit. And these friends, they start out so well. They start out with such good intentions of just sitting in silence and being with Job in his sorrow. And then they end the silence, and then they really want Job to kind of say how bad he is and recant and say that it was his fault. And Job holds steady, you know, like a convict in prison who till the end he says he's innocent. That's kind of what Job does here. So we can't go through all of the book of Job in one night because we've got an hour, right? But we're going to kind of go over some of the highlights of these three or four chapters. So we saw the story of Job. God appears to Job in an awesome way. And if you've got your Bibles, turn to Job chapter 38. And I just want to encourage you, on Wednesdays, perfect time to bring a Bible to church, because you're going to get to read along with us. Because on Wednesday nights, Sunday mornings, we have the verses on the screen, but Wednesday nights, we don't. And normally in the handout, I have it on here for you. But like tonight, when there's chapters that we're going to be digging through, weeding through, I can't put that on there. So I'm going to read some of these things, and we're just going to break these chapters down into some bite-sized chunks. Chapter 38, verse 1, then the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind. We got to stop there for a minute. Elihu speaks in chapter 36, I think verse 6. He speaks about a storm, doesn't he? He speaks about this storm, and you get this image that there was a storm brewing, and all of a sudden, chapter 38, the whirlwind hits. And what we're supposed to know, like, that whirlwind really symbolizes the divine presence of God. So if you remember back to Elijah, remember how the Lord appears to him in this whirlwind? The whirlwind was what took his kids out in the beginning of the book even, right? Like, this whirlwind, God even appears to Job in an amazing way through this whirlwind. And then verse 2 through 4, listen to what it says. Who is it that questions my wisdom with such arrogant or ignorant words? Brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. Now, I got to stop for a second, because one thing that's important before we read any further is to consider our tone. So I catch myself when I'm reading through this, I catch myself hearing the voice of God in a booming, angry tone. Like the Wizard of Oz, when the great and mighty Oz behind the curtain booms, "Who dares enter my chamber?" You know, that voice. Think of Gandalf the Great or the Gray. I don't know. Our cat's Gandalf the Gray. Is he the Gray or the Great in the movie? The Gray. Just like my cat. How cool that they named him in the book after my cat. You know how he says, "You shall not pass." That's the soundtrack in my mind when I read it. And what I have to do is I have to step back and remind myself of what I know to be true of God. Is he a punitive, mean, angry, hateful God? No. So why do I have the soundtrack run through my head as if he is Gandalf or the great and mighty Oz? Now, the whirlwind is fierce. Let's not kid ourselves and think that this was just a tiny funnel cloud and little butterflies swirling around in there. It was fierce. This was a scary moment. But I want us to know when, as we're reading through it, can you catch your tone as you hear it in your mind? Instead of seeing God as angry and hateful to his son that he loves so much, can we hear that tone? Still know it is a mighty sacred moment with this whirlwind and the power that comes with that. But can we hear the voice of God spoken in a different way, maybe, than what you hear? I don't want to read into it. But I naturally read into it. And so I have to force myself to try not to hear God as being angry and harsh to Job. So let's break this apart real quick. Chapter 38 and 39. Man, I sat in my office today just kind of breaking this out into what are these chunks? What really is he saying in these chunks? He's calling Job to attention. And this is what Job wanted, you guys. Job, for chapter after chapter, he's been begging the Lord to speak to him. And now God's ready, and he's going to speak to him. So what do we see in verse 4 through 7? He's asking Job, do you know the secrets of the creation of the world? He says, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you know so much. Who determined its dimensions and stretched out the surveying line? What supports its foundations, and who laid its cornerstone? As the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. What's God asking there? He's asking, do you know the secrets of the creation of the world? 8 through 11, he's saying, do you know the boundaries of the sea? Who kept the sea inside its boundaries as it burst from its womb? And as I clothed it with clouds and wrapped it in thick darkness, for I locked it behind barred gates, limiting its shores. I said, this far and no farther will you come. Here your proud waves must stop. God's explaining and asking him, do you understand? Every one of these, he's saying, do you know? Do you know about this? Do you know about this? The next few verses, he's asking, do you understand the nature of the earth? He's kind of changing gears. He was talking about the sea. Now he's saying, do you know the nature of the earth? Have you ever commanded the morning to appear and caused the dawn to rise in the east? Like even one day of your life. Bill, how old are you? 59 years old? You went 54. You've had a lot of days on this earth. Have you even one of those days commanded the sun to rise when you wanted? Not even one of those days. You tried, yes. I've tried to walk on water when I was a kid. Literally, I tried to walk on water. And I thought if I believed hard enough, I could walk on water, but I couldn't. Verse 13. Have you made daylight spread to the ends of the earth to bring an end to the night's wickedness? As the light approaches, the earth takes shape like day, pressed beneath a seal. It is robed in brilliant colors. The light disturbs the wicked and stops the arm that is raised in violence. Have you explored the springs from which the seas come? Have you explored their depths? Do you know where the gates of death are located? Have you seen the gates of utter gloom? Do you realize the extent of the earth? Tell me about it if you know. Oh, because when I read scripture, I pray that I will always have a reel playing in my mind. Because if you can do that, it will always be alive to you. It will always be something that is special, that is meaningful, instead of just words on a page. If you see the picture in your mind. And as I read that, I cannot help but imagine every word from God's mouth, what that is doing to Job. Every statement God's making, how much smaller does Job feel in that moment? How much more humble does he feel in that moment? Where am I? Verse 19, what does he do in 19 through 24? He's saying, do you understand the nature of light and darkness in the sky? Verse 25 through the next part, he's saying, do you understand the nature of the rain and its effects? Let's read a little bit of that. Who created a channel for the torrents of rain? Who laid out the paths for the lightning? Who makes the rain fall on barren land in a desert where no one lives? How beautiful. God doesn't have to water the desert where no one lives. And yet some things he just does for his pleasure. Like, why water the rainforest that is uninhabited? Except It's for his pleasure. Some things he just does because he takes delight in it. Verse 28, does the rain have a father? Who gives birth to the dew? Who's the mother of the ice? Who gives birth to the frost from the heavens? From the water, who turns ice as hard as a rock and the surfaces of the water freezes? Guys, do you, like, it's poetic even. This is beautiful and poetic language that God's speaking. 31 through 33, he's asking, do you understand the nature of the constellations? Can you direct the movements of the stars, binding the clusters of the Pleiades or loosening the cords of Orion? Can you direct the constellations through the seasons or guide the bear with her cubs across the heavens? Do you know the laws of the universe? Can you use them to regulate the earth? Here's what God's doing. God is not only pointing out his ignorance of things, he's pointing out his weakness. Not only do you not understand, you also don't have the power to do anything. You don't understand how everything was formed, and you don't even have the power to make the stars go where they're supposed to go or the sun rise. You're dumb and weak. I don't think God would say you're dumb and weak. Those are my words. But God is pointing out all these different nuances of the things that he's saying. And then if we keep going, what is he saying here? Verse 34 through 38. He's saying, do you understand the nature of the clouds, of the weather, and of the human mind? Verse 39 through 41, he's saying, do you understand the mysteries of the animal kingdom? And I got to tell you, I find chapter 39 amusing a little bit. Because in our culture, you do have people that would understand all the intricacies of a mountain goat, a donkey, an ox, an ostrich, a horse, a hawk, or an eagle. Some people will know some of those things. Like in Illinois where we lived, Bill Taylor knew this guy. He knew everything there was to know about pigs. That was his whole life's work. He specialized in hogs. He knew everything about a hog. He didn't know everything about dogs, donkeys, horses. Hogs were his specialty. And he was like world-renowned expert on all things hogs. God is world-renowned expert on all things everything, right? He knows it all. He is awesome. So we're not even going to get into chapter 39 because I just find it comical, all the different animals that God mentions. He is driving the nail in as far as it can go is what God is doing. He is showing, I am this awesome. And as awesome as you think I am, there's so much more to who I am than that. And chapter 40 is God's challenge and Job's response. Let's go look ahead there. Verse 1 through 2, we see God takes a breath. It's like he takes a breath for a second. I want to say tirade. He goes on this tirade, but it's not an angry tirade. He goes on this long questioning thing. Do you know about this? Do you know about this? And now, what? He get a TED Talk. There we go. And then he pauses for a drink. And what does he do? He takes a breath and he gives Job a chance to reply. Let's look at verse 1 through 2. Then the Lord said to Job, do you still want to argue with the Almighty? It's as if he's saying, have you had enough? Are you crying uncle yet? Have you had enough? You're God's critic, but do you have the answers? It's like God is saying, if you can answer these things, then you have a right to question me. Do you have the answer to any of those things? If you don't have the answer to any of those questions that I asked, you don't have the right to question me. Then he moves on in verse 3 through 5. Job is humbled and humble before God. You know what it is to be humbled. When someone humbles you, they put you in their place and let you know what they really think about you. That is being humbled. But he is also humble in this moment. God humbles him by asking him all these questions that he doesn't know the answer to. And now his response is he is humble in this. It says, then Job replied to the Lord, I'm nothing. How could I ever find the answers? I will cover my mouth with my hand. I've said too much already. I have nothing more to say. And God says, I'm not done. That's kind of what God says here. He's like, whoa, buddy, I'm not done with you, son. verse 6 through 7, listen where he says, then the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind again. Notice the whirlwind doesn't go away. The whirlwind, this mighty swirling presence of God is there. And now God speaks again. Then the Lord answered him from the whirlwind, brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you, and you must answer. God's got more. He's got more. Verse 8. Will you discredit my justice and condemn me just to prove you're right? Are you as strong as God? Can you thunder with a voice like his? All right, put on your glory and your splendor, your honor and your majesty. Give vent to your anger. Let it overflow against the proud. Humiliate the proud with a glance. Walk on the wicked where they stand. Bury them in the dust. Imprison them in the world of the dead. Then even I would praise you, for your own strength would save you. What do you think, God? Do you see the transition here? Like, tell me what you're hearing there. What do you see? What's that feeling of transition that we were noticing there? That's the huge transition there, isn't he? Now God goes from saying all the things that he did, and now he's really getting to the heart of the issue. God, because God knows our hearts, and Job feels like God did him wrong. You were unfair. Where were you, God, when all these things happened? That was good, Roger. That's exactly what we see happening in that section, and it's really poignant. Job's humbled and humble before God. God's not done. Verse 8 through 14, God asks, Job, are you fit to prove me wrong or to save yourself? Verse 15 through 24, God reminds Job of the vast difference between him and Job. He's comparing his might and Job's weakness. And he goes on and he talks about the behemoth, which is kind of a funny thing. He talks about the behemoth. He talks in chapter 41 about Leviathan. We're not even going to get into all that stuff right now. Let's jump to chapter 42. It is beautiful. What we see is kind of the end. Everything is wrapping up here. The chapter is getting ready to end. Then Job replied to the Lord. Because God, like over and over, God just keeps pounding it in. And then he gets to the heart of the matter because Job is saying, he's felt like he could do a better job. He's more just. He's more right than God. And now we're wrapping it up. And it says, then, verse 2, I know that you can do anything and no one can stop you. You asked, who is it that questions my wisdom with such ignorance? It's I. And I was talking about things I knew nothing about, things far too wonderful for me. Isn't that beautiful? I was just spouting off God. I was just saying things stupid, things I don't know anything about. He is so humbled in this moment because what God did is he showed him a picture of his awesomeness. And the natural response when we recognize how awesome he is, the natural appropriate response is that we respond with humility. Verse 5, I had only heard about you before, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. I take back everything I said, and I sit in dust and ashes to show my repentance. It's so beautiful. Do you feel for Job in this moment? Because I feel for Job. Because even God says Job was blameless and innocent, and it's the more he talked and the more he questioned that he got himself into trouble. But what a beautiful moment of repentance, and he humbles himself before an awesome God. And I can't stop without reading the conclusion, because when you go through all that Job went through, we need to see how it ends. So verse 7, after the Lord had finished speaking to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite. So now, by the way, Job's getting what he really wanted. Job really wanted some justice. Job really wanted God to put these guys in their place. And God knows. And these men they discredited God's man. They discredited Job. So God speaks to Eliphaz and he says, I'm angry with you and your two friends, for you have not spoken accurately about me. as my servant Job has. So take 7 bulls and 7 rams and go to the servant Job and offer a burnt offering for yourselves. My servant Job will pray for you, and I will accept his prayer on your behalf. I will not treat you as you deserve, for you have not spoken accurately about me, as my servant Job has. So Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite did as the Lord commanded them, and the Lord accepted Job's prayer. Imagine how those guys felt in this moment, like going with your tail between your legs, like humbling yourself and going before the man that you had accused. When Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortune. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much as before. Then all his brothers, sisters, and former friends came and feasted with him in his home. And they consoled him and comforted him because of all the trials the Lord had brought against him. And each of them brought him a gift of money and a gold ring. So the Lord blessed Job in the second half of his life even more than in the beginning. For now he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camel, 1,000 teams of oxen, and 1,000 female donkeys. He also gave Job 7 more sons and 3 more daughters. He named his first daughter Jemima. The second, and I'm going to stop there because there's a bunch of hard names. In the land, no women were as lovely as his daughters, the daughters of Job. And their father put them into his will along with their brothers. Job lived 140 years after that, living to see 4 generations of his children and grandchildren. Then he died, an old man who had lived a long, full life. Isn't that beautiful? So beautiful. But man, he went through some crud, didn't he? He went through some stuff. He went through some stuff. And I wanted us to spend some time thinking about that story. But I also want to move on. There's another chapter in Isaiah chapter 40, which really reads quite a bit like the story of Job. It's just a more condensed version. Like, look up Isaiah chapter 40. But let's look at Psalm 33 real quick. I'm going to read verse 6 through 9, and then I'm going to go back and read a few verses before that. The Lord merely spoke, and the heavens were created. He breathed the word, and all the stars were born. He assigned the sea its boundaries and locked the oceans in its vast reservoirs. Let the whole world fear the Lord, and let everyone stand in awe of him. For when he spoke, the world began. It appeared at his command. And I rearranged these verses. I didn't change the word of God. But I reordered this because I know Revelation. I know what it says. So I'm not in danger of anything. But now let's go back. Let's flip this around. And the reason I did that is because this is the response. Like, I worship because of what we just read. Because of God's greatness, let the godly sing for joy to the Lord. It is fitting for the pure to praise him. Praise the Lord with melodies on the lyre. Make music for him on the 10-stringed harp. Sing a new song of praise to him. Play skillfully on the harp and sing with joy, for the word of the Lord holds true, and we can trust everything he does. He loves whatever is just and good. The unfailing love of the Lord fills the earth. That is the right response when the creation comes into contact with the awesome creator. The natural and right response is humility. That's humility, isn't it? Let's move down to this last part, the identity of the creation. Hebrews 12, 28 through 29, since we're receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe. For our God is a devouring fire. Our God is a whirlwind. Our God is a creator. Our God is awesome. And we're not actually probably going to take time to do this exercise, but I would challenge you to do this on your own. So here's this exercise. Look at Romans 11, verse 33 through 36. If you look at this, this is what a preacher would do, guys. A preacher would take a passage of scripture like this, and we would read it all, and then we would step back from it for a second, and we would try to get an overall idea. What is this text saying? Then I'm going to go back in, okay? I'm going to go back into that text, and I'm going to pull apart the words and the lines, and I'm going to see, can I find some clear, coherent thoughts that run through this? A lot of the times, some preachers, like I will do, Paul's better at this than I am, way better, we'll take words and we'll try and use some form of alliteration, like where at the beginning, chapter, at the summary of Job 1 through 37, I said, testing, things taken, terrible tragedy, tormenting talks. The alliteration, sometimes it's cheesy when we go overboard, and I've been guilty of that before, okay? But sometimes that alliteration helps us remember things. It's the same way we would remember what when someone has a stroke, what are the things that you're supposed to do? Call the ambulance. You're looking for your face, F-A-C-E, right? Yeah, you're right, that because that alliteration helps us remember those things. Anyway, stop, drop, and roll. Just anytime you have some, that's not really alliteration, but anytime you have some way that you can flow a thought together, it helps us remember it. And so what we would do then, if you're a preacher, which y'all can be preachers, you can preach on your own, right? You would take this passage, I would read the whole thing and say, what's the whole thing about? Like, get an overarching thought or a word. This really is about the greatness of God, the awesomeness of God. Now I want to take each verse. And can I pull each verse apart? And can I see, can you pull out two or three main points from each of those verses? Let's just practice real quick. Verse 33. Let's read the whole thing. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Some of Paul's sentences are so, there's different thoughts added in. It's not just like God is awesome, period. It is, oh, the blank, and the, you know what I mean? He's adding a lot of things. So you have to read it a couple times and read it slow. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay them? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. So then what we would do is we, like, I left you some space here to see, can you do this? Can you go through and pull apart and see, like, what are 2 points? What are 3 thoughts? What are the main words or the main thoughts that you're seeing in each sentence? Like, those are skills that you learn when you study the Bible. It's not just reserved for preachers. You can do this too. And when you do it, you're gonna see new things. You're gonna see things that you hadn't seen before. Here's my last thought. The mysteries of God lead us in one of 2 directions. I believe this with all my heart. The mysteries of God. The scripture tells us that the hidden things belong to God. The things that belong to us are the things that he reveals. But there are things about God that we don't get. And if we could, I say it so often, if you could get all the things of God, he's too small. We've made our God too small. The mysteries of God lead us in one of 2 directions. Either you give up your faith altogether and become a skeptic, or you bow the knee before the God who is too great, too vast, too awesome for you to fully comprehend, and you reply like Paul did in verse 36, to him be the glory forever. Amen. To him be the glory forever. Amen. So here's what I'd like us to do. I'd like you to, I mean, you do have some time if you want to take me up on this challenge. And if you do, I'd love to see what your thoughts were. Can you come up with some things as you do this, as you read through those verses again on your own? But I've asked Brent or Corey to play the song, So Will I. We know this song. But what I want is for us to not sing it. I want us to simply listen to it and think about it. It is, guys, it is so easy for me to sing. It's easier for me to sing than it is to pray. And it's easier for me to sing than it is to think. Because I know the words and I can just turn my thinking brain off and just start singing the song. And so I did this today. I sat here and I listened to this song and I wanted to sing. And there's a place and a time for singing. But it was when I just thought about the words that I was hearing that I felt felt it. Like I was in that moment. I was feeling it. I was declaring it in my heart. And I just felt this glory, this presence of God when I didn't sing, when I just forced my brain to think and to focus as hard as I could on what I was hearing. Can y'all do that with me tonight? And so I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you to not sit by somebody, even if it's your spouse, but just to get a little space. Like I can pray with my husband. I can sing with my husband. I can worship the Lord with my husband, but he does distract me because he's really fun and sweet. And I like to hold his hand. So sometimes for me, it's nice to have a little space in this moment. So I'm going to encourage you to find another chair. It doesn't have to be across the room, but find another space. They're going to play this song, and then we're going to come back together, and we're going to pray together.